speaker is Joe Mazumdar, editor, Exploration Insights. Joe joined Brent Cook as co-editor and analyst of Exploration Insights in December 2015 and transitioned into being the sole editor a couple of years later. Previously, he spent 6 years as senior mining analyst at Haywood Securities and Canaccord Genuity in Vancouver. Before that, he was director of strategic planning corporate development at Newmont Mining, and prior to that, senior market analyst commodity trader at Phelps Dodge, now Freeport McMoRan, Phoenix. Before becoming a mining market analyst, he worked for over a decade as an exploration geologist in different capacities for IM Gold, North Minerals, and RTZ in South America, MIM Exploration in Queensland, Australia, and Noranda and others in Western Canada and the Northwest Territories. He has a Bachelor of Science in Geology from the University of Alberta, a Master of Science in Geology and Mining from James Cook University, and a Master of Science in Mineral Economics from the Colorado School of Mines. He will be discussing copper near-term versus long-term, challenge in raising funds in the current market.
Thank you. Sorry. No, it's my fault. Thank you. And thanks to Ian for the invitation. I think the last time I was here was about 5 years ago. It'll be about the copper market. I've got a lot of slides to go through, so I'll just go through them. This is probably a good takeaway in terms of demand, price, and supply, what's happening near-term and long-term. So the near-term issue if you look at copper price, one proxy for demand is usually industrial production, especially Chinese. And right now with higher interest rates, that's being negatively impacted. The higher interest rates are to slow inflation, but it's also impeding economic growth, negative for copper. China's growth impacted by a weak real estate market. Their debt burdens are increasing, higher interest rates, negative for copper. Medium-term demand, this is what we're all living for and hoping for, is positive, with not only EVs, but also clean energy technologies. Because, copper is substitutable, but what you substitute it for is not as good as copper. Okay, and then price, what's holding down the price as well of all commodities, is the stronger US dollar. We thought it was gonna get weaker, it didn't. And with all the geopolitical crisis in the world, the US dollar is a safe haven. Gold is as well, but the impact, as you would have seen with the incident in Israel, is it's ephemeral. It doesn't last long. So in terms of supply, everything's actually, it's sort of negative in terms of the industry because we suck, but it's good for the price. Because copper supply disruptions, whether it's Peru or, wherever, that's positive for the price. Like I remember when I was trading copper back in 2003 and 4, what moved the copper market was a big slide at Grasberg. Took 500,000 tons, I think, off the copper market. And at that time, the copper market was tight, and that just pushed it over the limit. And I grew up with 50 cents. We shut everything down under 75 at Phelps Dodge. And then we were bringing everything up in about a year and a half as copper went to a buck. And that's what really triggered it. Lack of infrastructure, and this is a big one because a lot of these projects we talk about, resources, there's just no infrastructure to build them. They'll never happen. So you could talk about how many pounds of this and how many pounds of that. It's just not going to happen. So that lack of infrastructure and anybody actually building the infrastructure, which is not happening now, hasn't happened, and now with higher interest rates, almost can't happen. And then geopolitical risks and creeping nationalism. A bit with Chile, nationalizing lithium worries people about copper. We have, places like Mali increasing the amount of ownership of the government. So all of that stuff makes people not want to invest. And what does that do? It slows down project development. So a lot of this stuff that you'll see with base case production, probable, possibles, and all that that's supposed to fill this gap potentially because of demand, I'll show you one of these curves, might not ever happen. It'll just keep getting deferred. And I'll show you some of these projects as well. So increasing financing risk. So even if you could build it, could you fund it? And now it's getting more expensive to get debt. I mean, you can get it, but now it's going to cost you a lot more. And then the other problem that we have that I think they talked about yesterday, I mean, there's nothing wrong with geologists. You guys are very important. And I was one. I guess I still am. But it's the mining engineers, the metallurgists, everybody. There's just, we don't produce them, at least in Western countries. They are getting produced, but maybe we'll find them in Zambia. Maybe eventually we'll get them in the DRC. You know, maybe more will happen in other countries where the projects actually are built, but that'll take time. So all of that, sort of, this is the near term. This is what's happening now. This is why the sentiment is negative. But on the other side, there's things here underpinning why people have positive sentiment in copper, and that's the dichotomy that we live in. And so this, near term, like the medium term, is more about like the whole world going to this carbon neutral technology. It's not China specific. But China, near term, still medium term, is still very important. So in terms of global concentrate, they take 55% of it, you know, and that's just about their smelting capacity globally is about, they have more than half of it. So over the 20 years, since 2003-ish, that's what they've been doing. And I'll show you this graphic on processing. It's a big drop off to Japan. And, you know, when I worked in copper for RTZ here, the TCRCs, the treatment charges and refining charges, were basically negotiated every half year in Hawaii between the Japanese smelters and BHP. That's how it happened. That's not how it happens anymore. The Chinese dictate, and everybody else follows. So, and then we talk about the U.S. and their, you know, carbon neutral technology and what they want to do and all this stuff. You know, they don't even have any smelting capacity. And so in terms of that graphic, I can't even get the U.S. on it. There's like 0.05%. And so in terms of the demand, why people are positive, it's all these different technologies, different ways of, let's say, skinning the cat. I'm not sure if that translates to Chilean. I'm going to wait to see what she says. Okay, I got some laughs. Okay, that's good. So most of these technologies, we talk about the battery. Everybody's like fascinated with the battery, rightfully so. We talk about lithium. We talk about the anode with graphite, which can be synthetically produced. We talk about cobalt. We talk about now rare earths as well for the magnets, for the cars as well. But if you don't have the infrastructure, like Nikki was saying, you don't have anything. You can't power any of this stuff. And not only the infrastructure for the car, but also the infrastructure to charge the cars, but also all these other technologies, whether it's solar, wind turbines, hydrogen technologies, all of it needs copper. And so if we look at this graphic, so it's not only that you've got new demand growth, but it's the intensity of use in each one of these products that just jacks up the amount of copper you need. So the blue there is the copper in how much you would need kilogram for vehicle for your EV, for your electric vehicle. So a conventional car, you can see that you need probably two or three times for an EV for the same car. Power generation, offshore wind, requires a lot of copper. Onshore wind, solar PVs less, but still they need it. So the issue about a lot of the critical minerals is technology is not constant. And you can see that, for example, with cobalt. Like cobalt, everybody wanted cobalt, but as they found out that they couldn't get cobalt as fast as they wanted to, and then a lot of it was coming from the Congo, the engineers engineered cobalt out of the battery. Less and less cobalt in more advanced batteries. And now, you know, they've got LFP batteries, lithium iron phosphate batteries. So there's a whole bunch of different things people can do to remove a critical mineral from the battery, except for lithium. But you can't do that with copper. And so this is another thing. So if we're talking about demand, you know, and not just with EVs, but with energy, you can see right now that oil is going to be oil. It's still going to be there. It's flatlined at about 45% of global power is oil. And that might not go away anytime soon. The one that's actually being replaced is coal. So coal peaked at over 20%, and now it's at about 11 or 12. But you could see that if you include hydro, solar, wind, and other renewables, that's now almost 25% or more. So that is growing. And all that needs copper as well. And then if you look at electric vehicles, the problem with electric vehicles is some of these models of penetration. I don't think it's going to be as good as they say, but still. So if you could see the growth there, so 2023, you can see this graphic on the left. This graphic on the left is basically what they think is going to happen. So this is 2040, 2030, 2020. And that's the growth in EVs. That's, you know, whatever. And then on this graphic is like the penetration you need globally. So you're replacing an ICE, internal combustion engine, with an electric vehicle. You're not increasing the amount of vehicles, but you're increasing the proportion or the penetration of EVs into a market. Every market is different. Like the US will never be 80%, I can guarantee that. And some countries don't have the infrastructure. Like if you go to Brazil, they make cars. BYD, the biggest car manufacturer in China, is building a plant here to get the lithium from the Salar de Atacama. And they're also building an LFP plant in Brazil. And then when I was in Brazil, I asked, well, why don't you just bloody well build the cars? Are you going to say bloody? No, okay, good. So why don't you just build the cars? He said, nobody wants them. We don't sell EVs in Brazil. So that could be a problem in some places. But if we look here, so this is where EVs started, like 2.9 million cumulative in 2020. Now, 14.9, so almost five times growth in 4 years. So the growth rates are amazing, and so you could see that as well with these lines here in terms of monthly sales. So it is happening. Whether we get here or not, I don't know. But there is a lot of these EVs being built, which is good for copper. So from a Western perspective, Western meaning, let's say, not China, this is what they want. They want to decouple, which is impossible, from China. They don't want what happened during COVID, but now, geopolitically, they don't want to have too much connected to China. So what they're trying to say is like, you know, here's all, this was by the International Energy Agency, but these are the things we need, where we get them from. So if we just stick to copper, the U.S., if you look at it from their perspective, they have free trade agreements with Chile and Peru. So theoretically, they look pretty good in terms of copper exposure. They don't look good with respect to graphite, rare earths, South Africa, platinum, or the DRC cobalt, maybe. But saying that, I was in South Africa in February. 2 months before I got there, Anthony Blinken, the Secretary of State, was in the DRC and Zambia making bilateral agreements with them. And then recently, Trafigura, a trading company, is committed to build a railway from the Central African Copper Belt to a port, Lobito, in Angola. Why? Because they don't want to take the copper out through Chinese infrastructure because all that is taking the copper to China. They want the copper to go to the West. The only way they could do that is build the infrastructure. So that's getting back to the lack of infrastructure, but people are willing to do that. It's like, if you build it, they will come. If anybody remembers that movie. Anyway, so this does look good, but I'll show you that it doesn't look as good as you think. So from the other perspective, the Chinese perspective, you know, they're looking at copper from Chile and Peru as well. Because, a couple of years ago, it's either Chile or Peru. They go back and forth being the biggest exporter of copper into China. But, you know, we're seeing these commitments by China to get closer to, to nickel in Indonesia by building downstream facilities. And now they're doing that in Chile and in Brazil. Their big worry is Australia. So they get most of their lithium from spodumene dikes, lithium oxide concentrates. And they've built up all this processing capacity to treat those. But if Australia decides, you know, well, it's not going to go to you, it's going to go to somebody else, then they're kind of screwed. So what they've done is they've invested, I think, over $1 billion in the Salar de Uyuni with Bolivia. So they're going to try their direct lithium extraction technology there. So everybody is maneuvering, and that's all happening now and will continue to happen. What's interesting about Brazil and potentially Chile as well and most of South America is that they're not going to play favorites. They're not going to say all of this lithium or all of this copper is going to go to the West. It's going to go to the highest bidder or the person that, you know, builds the most infrastructure, gives us more value add in the country. So this is a capital expenditure graphic. So the first bit, this bit here is diversified majors. And then this gap here is focused companies in copper, nickel, and cobalt, and the top is lithium. So you can see that, you know, back in 2010, there was about over 20 billion cumulatively spent by these companies in their capital cycles. Now it's over 40. But now we're just getting back to the last peak. But that last peak did not talk about green technologies and did not talk about electric vehicles. And you can see that lithium wasn't even there then. So this probably needs to get higher. And soon. So if we just take that graphic, but now look at specific companies that are specifically copper, like Freeport, like First Quantum, and like Southern Copper. So if you look at that, you know, the first blue here is Freeport, then it's First Quantum, and the last one's Southern. So their total lowest CapEx was 2020, just like that other graph showed you. And then this is my estimate, just doubling their half, you know, which simplistic. And it might not be the same for both halves, but I can guarantee you whatever they estimated for the first half is going to be higher in the second half with the way the oil prices are going. And so we were talking previously, or maybe not, about development timelines. And so this is the big, I don't want to steal from Stuart, but this is the elephant in the room. It's not disguised, it's right there. It could take over 16 years from discovery to production. So if we don't know this project, and I'll show you the demand and supply curves, it's not going to happen. It's not going to meet the need. So we talked about delays. Resolution Copper. When I worked as an analyst for Phelps Dodge, we had this project coming in 2010. I don't know, what is it, 2023? Yeah, so who knows? And they go back and forth depending on the administration in the US. And that's a big deposit that they think could take 25% of the total copper demand of the US. But remember, they don't have a smelter that could take that. Another one, Pebble, 320 million pounds of copper potentially annually, 378,000 ounces of gold. U.S. Corps of Engineers, where this has to go through because it deals with water, waters of the United States. So if you ever go to the States, which you probably have, WOTUS is the acronym. And if you have WOTUS, you need to go through the U.S. Corps of Engineers. It doesn't matter if you're all on private land. If you touch WOTUS, the U.S. Corps of Engineers will touch you. And this has been going on every 60 days where they keep giving 60-day extensions because they don't want to make a decision. Another one, a local company, Antofagasta Minerals, Twin Metals Copper Nickel Project, apparently too close to the Boundary Water Canoe Area Wilderness. These mining leases were actually granted in 1966. There's never been a mine here. Another one, Rosemont. So this is, Hudbay acquired this, and then in May 2022, the Supreme Court of the state basically ruled that, you know, they upheld the blocking of this. So they've accepted that, and now they're building another project entirely on private land, which is basically almost what you have to do in the States now. Okay, and this is really the elephant in the room, the processing capacity. So since 2020-ish, all that time that we were happy with shoving manufacturing to China, that's what they've been doing. Basically building up their capacity to process anything. And that's 20 years of technology, 20 years of development, 20 years of having, you know, anywhere from 40 to 80% of the processing capacity for a lot of these critical minerals. You can't replicate this in 5 years. And you know how long it takes to permit anything in some places. And so if we look, given you know, what we know about China and what we know about Chile, it's not surprising most of the copper concentrate or the copper from Chile goes to China. You know, over 50%. And that's because China also, huge demand, but they've also got all the smelters. Remember that it's the smelters that demand the concentrate. That's where the demand is. And so the TCRC is really the price. And if you have more smelters, you're going to want more copper. And so they take most of it. Chile has a free trade agreement with the U.S. And so under their Inflation Reduction Act, copper from Chile can go to an electric vehicle and get the discount. But the problem is the U.S. needs cathode. They don't want concentrate because they have no smelting capacity. And the future, as we all know, is for concentrate, not much more SXEW. And so that means more smelting capacity globally. So what we're seeing is that China's actually increasing its smelting capacity for copper. They're looking at actually building one of the biggest smelters that exists. Right now, this Anhui with 2 million tons per year capacity, that's going in to production. They, you know, they're permitting, they permit pretty quick. And if they say they're going to build it, they'll build it. So what's happening now is a lot more smelting capacity is being shoved back to the mines. Like, First Quantum is expanding their Kansanshi smelter in Zambia, the DR Congo, that's expanding. Indonesia as well, they were always forced to build smelting capacity. That's what Freeport had to do. At Newmont, we got out before we built it. The last smelter in Chile was built in 1990. I mean, when I started with Phelps Dodge in 2003, they were just dismantling the San Manuel smelter and sending it to China. So the thing is that Chile right now has this MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, with the European Commission regarding critical minerals to help them facilitate investment in that. But they're also working with Arubis. And apparently your left-wing government here wants to build up the smelting capacity here. So that'll be interesting to see if they can. But it would be definitely something to feed the U.S. market. And so somebody else was talking before about copper grade and the ESG impact. And so you can see it here. Like, the first line, the green line, is the concentrate grade going from 1% to about 0.8 average. And then the heap leaching, the SXEW, going from about 0.7 to 0.6. And that's just less. But if you look at the energy intensity, one thing is grade, in terms of, you know, the lower the grade, higher energy intensity, higher carbon footprint, but also between SXEW and concentrate. But we know both trends are negative. The trend is lower grade, and the other trend is less SXEW. So our ESG footprint is just going to go up. So that's why people talk about green copper and all this other stuff. I can tell you the Chinese do not care. They'll take it. And so what, how are people trying to get around that? Like, not only building the smelters, but also new technology. I mean, at Phelps Dodge, we tried leaching and all this stuff. Never worked. But it was a good tool to negotiate with the smelters with. But it never worked. This may work. But you saw people talking about Newton. When they talk about the Rio Tinto investment, it's not Rio Tinto. It's actually their subsidiary, Newton, which is its own technology, its own company, that's basically investing in companies to see if their leach technology works. So they'll first come to you, they'll take a sample, see if it works, they'll do an equity private placement, and then they'll do more test work. That's happening, I believe, with McEwen. That's happening with a company in Arizona called Arizona Sonora. And they've done several of these. And so that would take the smelter out of it, out of the equation. And then you'd be making cathode. But again, this technology doesn't work everywhere. You need a lot of pyrite to, I think, feed the bacteria. The bacteria needs low pH, and it needs to generate its own heat. So if you've got a low sulfur deposit, low sulfide deposit, it's not going to work. And so this is the demand and supply curve. So this is the deficits that everybody talks about. I mean, it's more about 2027, 28, basically, where we start expanding this market deficit. This has got a lot of underlying assumptions. So we're assuming here that refined copper production is constrained to about 3.5% compound annual growth rate from 2022. And we're also assuming that we hit most of the expectations with EVs and technology, and we're growing at 4.5 to 5%, which is not like a small rate. That's pretty good. Like 5% CAGR on copper is like a good rate. So this doesn't have a lot of this is not pessimistic. This is optimistic, but that's where the gap's going to come. And so, like I said, if the gap is here in 2027 building up, that's, what, 4 or 5 years, and if you get a project now, you know, bring it into production, we're talking 15. So we have to know what we know now. And this is why we have M&A. So if we look here, that green there is copper. And so M&A activity peaked just last year over this last 7, 8 years. Most of it was copper. Because the industry knows the problem. The retail sector, they just want to sell. Institutional equity almost doesn't exist anymore. Private equity knows if they can get money, which is hard to get when you could put it in the bank for 8%. It's hard to give it to a fund that makes 5. But the big thing about our supply and demand model doesn't change. This is just consolidation. It's not nothing new. The only difference is sometimes is if a new company comes in, let's say Lundin into Caserones, which they did, they suddenly have the cash to do more exploration and potentially expand the plant, whereas the Japanese didn't want to do that. So that could actually grow production. But if it's just buying to buy, it's not going to change anything. So this is what Nikki was talking about. So the U.S. Department of Energy put out this near-term and medium-term. And there's a difference between strategic and critical. So what's getting funded now is not critical, it's strategic. And those strategic minerals are lithium and rare earths. That's what's getting funded directly by the Department of Energy. They want to give $1 billion to Thacker Pass, a lithium project there, and they're looking at rare earth element projects like Mountain Pass. But you can see where copper went. So in the short term, it's not up there with respect to these other ones. But in the medium term, it's coming up. And that's your 2026, 2027. And so, I got 4 slides. Oh, did you hear me? Okay. You heard me, right? Okay, so Chile's copper endowment, this is the good thing about Chile, is you can't get away from the fact you've got copper, even though you might not want to mine it, you might not want to smelt it, you might not even want to find it. You've got it. And, you know, out of these top 15 mines, 7 of them are yours. You know, so anybody who says Chile is not still prospective for copper is probably out of their minds. But your constraint, just like Nikki was saying, everywhere is process water. And it's not potable. You cannot compete for potable water. You'll never get it. You're going to have to take desal, or you're going to have to take water that nobody can drink. Because if there's any water for potable as well in the U.S., you'll never get it. And so this is a cost curve, just specifically for Chile is highlighted. So what's interesting to me is Codelco's in trouble, I know. They sold bonds, $2 billion. But they're looking to expand this Ministroales, I hope I pronounced that right, that's right here, low cost right now. But they want to, you know, they want to put another $2.5 billion into it. You know, but then Antofagasta is building a desal plant for Zaldívar to extend it by 20 years. But geez, I mean, Zaldívar is, yeah, that's low cost too, so that makes sense. Chile, you know, whatever we say about the left-wing government, they approved a $3 billion expansion or extension of Las Bronces. But look at where Las Bronces is. I mean, that is not a Q1 project. So if you're going to invest and want to expand that, you're not thinking this is a spot copper price. You're not thinking that copper is going to stay at 350. There's just no way. And also Lundin's Candelaria, they got $600 million expansion approved. You know, that's still Q3, third quartile. None of these guys are investing. None of these guys are buying thinking that copper is going to stay at 350. And so if we look at exploration, which is getting to what you guys do, Latin America, so that black line is the proportion of the total exploration globally that comes to Latin America. So actually, when global exploration peaked in 2012, the proportion that went to Latin America was actually down. Why? Because a lot of the higher risk jurisdictions were getting money. And Latin America wasn't getting that money. They were getting money. I mean, it went up. Like you can see, it went up. But it didn't go up as high as some other places. But now, Latin America is back over 40% because these other places are not getting money anymore. And so if you look at it from a risk perspective, okay, and so this is control risk with S&P Global Market Intelligence. So the first one is political, economic, legal, taxes, operational security. I don't know why Chile's security is so high, but anyway. But still, out of Latin America, and these are mining countries, they're gold, copper, what have you, you know, they're still right now look to be the best. So So in, still in terms of risk profile, Chile's still okay. I mean, good. But they really got to sort out their royalty. They got to stabilize what they actually want from the mining industry, because that is going to hold back a bit of investment. But right now, it's still looking good. In terms of Latin America being more important again, Chile being important as well. And so this is just copper. So Chile in 2022 was the number one destination for exploration. But problematically, you know, there's not a lot of companies. That's because there's a lot of big companies, but you guys don't let a lot of juniors in. And juniors really drive the market in Australia and Canada to discover. So that might help. And then if we look at this, I'm almost finished. The trend in exploration. So I did this in Africa as well when I was in whatever that thing's called in Africa. So there, Africa, on average, the exploration expenditures in Africa were like 35% of their 2012 peak. That's where they were sitting at. And so the ones that were getting the money actually were the highest risk countries, like the DRC and Mali. And you almost got the same thing here. Like this first bar, the darker bar, is the 2022 exploration budget for each country. Latin America, important countries, and the US and Canada as a foil there. But, and then these boxes here are basically the percent of the last peak, which was mostly 2012. So you could see the ones that are hitting new peaks are Ecuador and Argentina. And Chile is still sitting at 70% of its peak. Even though it's getting most of the money, it could do much better. Okay, finally, conclusions. So near-term market volatility, all the reasons I told you. Medium-term to long-term is all what we're hoping about. Carbon neutral technologies. And this competition, West and East, is not going away soon. So, but there'll be so many different things happening. But I think Chile is exposing themselves to either market. So I don't think they're going to make any kind of alignment. Capital expenditures, higher financing costs, oil prices are going up, capital's going to go up. So can we fund it? And how much is it going to cost? That's all going to go up. Again, mining only half the problem with processing. Hence the idea of increasing smelting capacity closer to the actual mines. Rising volume of copper and concentrate implies more diversification for smelters, lower grade deposits, higher ESG footprint, leaching to get around smelters. That's a new thing. Deficits grow after 2026. With our assumptions, copper is critical, but medium term. But as I showed you, if we don't know it now, there is no medium term. Nothing's going to show up for that gap. Again, Chile, well endowed, adequate infrastructure, which is very important, and the potential to deliver more mine production with these expansions, and hopefully smelter capacity to deliver cathode to the US. And that's it for me. Thank you very much.